Record button. So once again, welcome all. Welcome, Gunther. Today we have with us a great speaker and a fellow colleague who has quite some experience behind him. He is the man behind a book, Scrum Pocket Guide. I must admit, I didn't read the second edition. I read the first one, so but I'll have to check up the update and errata. And
errata? Errata? What do you mean errata?
There's always some errata. Updates. Okay. He will today be with us, and he'll guide us through Scrum values and why was the name chosen, the Scrum at Heart, because that is something that is basically essential to Scrum or essential to any moral compass there. Why are these five chosen? Could it be that we could have gone for something else? That's some of the things that we might discuss. And I invite you all to drop comments, drop in whenever you can. We will be more than happy to listen and support. Thanks a lot. Gunther, please do take over.
Okay, great. Thanks very much for the introduction, Bogdan, and also Boris for helping to organize this. So it's great to be here. Indeed, it was about, so this is called Scrum Wednesdays. I'm not going to try to pronounce it the way that you do, okay? But still, cool. So that sort of, we are all facing this problem that we have to work at home. At least it has helped me to get sort of connected to you guys with this community. Otherwise, I would have had to travel all the way to Belgrade and do something. So this is fine too. So about the Scrum values, maybe some background. My idea of the Scrum values or some ideas about it in history is the following. So the Scrum values for the first time ever were described in the first book by Ken Schwaber. I don't know if anybody knows the book. It's called Agile Software Development with Scrum. It was from a really long time ago. It must have been 2001 or 2002. I always make a mistake over there, but around that time. So at least a very long time ago. Now the Scrum values were only described as a sort of attachment appendix in the book of Ken. It was not just Ken, by the way, also Mike Beadle. So the book by Ken Schwaber and Mike Beadle. And they described it in the sense that they saw those values being enacted more and more in a number of Scrum implementations. So they had been looking, so they had been helping people to implement Scrum. Now remember back in 2001 or 2002, that was even around the Agile Manifesto. Scrum was not around like it is today. It was not globally adopted. It was not the most adopted method for software development and product development anyhow. So it was sort of very obscure. So imagine all the implementations they did by the end of the 90s. And then Ken, Wichev and other people, Mike and other great people, looking into Scrum implementations. And what they saw, a lot of them had in common, at least, so sort of those values being enacted more. And that is how Ken described it in his first book. Now, after that, it seems that the Scrum values sort of disappeared in a way. And I was pointed back to them somewhere by the end of 2012, so that's 10 years later, in a class by a fellow professional Scrum trainer like Bogdan, who was attending a class by me to become a trainer himself, so I was training trainers. And he asked about, hey Gunther, the Scrum values, are they still sort of real? Do they still exist? Do we still believe in them? So I sent a mail back in 2012 to Ken Schwaber, asking that sort of same question, and said, yes, of course, but we haven't given it a lot of attention. And I felt like maybe this is a good time to do that. So I wrote a blog note about it, the value in the Scrum values, that blog note is called. And then I included my text about the Scrum values in the first edition of my book. So that's the one that Bogdan has read. So I always have a copy around. So I updated my book in 2018, was published by the beginning of 2019. So this is the what it says, the second edition. And I that was certainly one chapter that I almost didn't touch. So I updated a lot of stuff throughout my book. So back then, if you want to know, it's too much to mention and still not that much because the essence is sort of the same. Just language, how I speak about Scrum has been sort of updated. But I kept this chapter on the Scrum values. And that was 2013, and then the update in 2019. And back in 2016, the Scrum values were briefly added to the Scrum guide. And I think that was a really good sign because we were, I feel, transcending, almost outgrowing the purely, let's say, technical implementation of Scrum. Because the Scrum guide, in a way, is more like a technical description of Scrum, if you want. And just by adding the Scrum values was a really good thing. So that's sort of how I see. Now, honestly, at this point in time, my text on the Scrum values on my blog is my most read blog note on my blog ever. And nothing will ever come even close. So that must mean that there is some sort of demand for Scrum values or for the values. Now, what I like a lot about the Scrum values is the fact that I will go through them. They're sort of not just values, you know, fluffy, puffy things up there in the sky. They easily translate into behavior, actions, things you do. And that makes the Scrum value so powerful. But also, again, difficult, because that means that you have to actively translate those values into specific behaviors. And that's important because you can only do that understanding the background of Scrum, the fundamentals, the principles of Scrum, meaning complexity, unpredictability, and so on. And when Bogdan asked me to talk about the Scrum values, I had to think about it a little bit because I haven't actively spoke about just the Scrum values, but more in the sense like in Scrum, in Ken's first book, the Scrum values as a result of implementing Scrum. And the way I look at the Scrum values, because we have this sometimes very sort of dualistic thinking, people think, yeah, but what do we do first? Do we implement Scrum and the rules and the framework as is described in the Scrum guide? Or should we start with the values first? And that's not the one or the other. They go hand in hand. I like to look at the Scrum values almost like a sort of thermometer, a barometer of your Scrum implementation. Meaning by implementing Scrum and the core practices of Scrum, how to do that. After a while, you should see those values being enacted more. And by maybe putting the values in the front, in the front again, that might help people think on, oh yeah, how to adjust how they apply Scrum. So they go hand in hand. And in a way, they're like a way to assess almost sort of the maturity, I hate that word, but sort of the maturity, the level of your Scrum. Now, there's different ways to look at the values. And over the past 1 or 2 years, I've been speaking a lot about what I call the illusion of agility, agile transformations, Scrum, and lately, certainly the last almost year, a lot about engagement. So at the request of Bogdan, I've combined what I've been talking about, agility, illusion of agility, and engagement, and get the Scrum values in there. And I prepared a little presentation for you guys, so let's go through that. So this is sort of the opening statement I have when I talk about engagement being the key. And I'll explain later on why. So this is my statement. So employees who are engaged actually care a lot more. Whenever I bring up this statement, most people seem to agree. I don't remember running into somebody who doesn't agree. Now, if I expand my statement a little bit, it will be employees who are engaged actually care a lot more about outcomes for the team, for their customers, and for their enterprise. And I'll come back on those things. Now, that's not a statement I totally made up myself. It's something I believe, I've seen. But I've got some research to back that up. So let's go there. And that's sort of the idea of engagement is the key. It's a way to look at Scrum from the point of view engagement, which is connected to the Scrum values. And the idea is, how about putting people at the heart of your Scrum? And something I strongly believe in, use Scrum as a tool to humanize the workplace, create a more humane work environment for people. So putting people at the heart of Scrum, that automatically means, like Bogdan said when introducing this, it's more like your values, like your moral compass. That's something for people. That's not something you can instruct. So let's have a look at what I mean. But before we go into that, I felt like, oh, I'm working on the Scrum values. So I have my blog note. I have the text in my book. I will have a text also in an upcoming book I'm working on for O'Reilly Media in the US, a publication. It's called 97 Things Every Scrum Practitioner Should Know. So I've worked with a number of people across the world and collected 97 articles included in a book. I've contributed one myself about the Scrum values. Now, this is a very condensed, very dense description of the Scrum values. So as an introduction to this session, before we go into engagement and all my story, let me read this for you first. I've been recently reading also about my little book. So Bogdan, if you don't want to read the book, I've also been reading it. It's out there on YouTube, my YouTube channel. So I took 5 sessions to read through my book during this crisis to help people out a little. But allow me to read this for you guys. So the Scrum values. Scrum offers room and opportunities for people to collaborate, explore, and experiment. Scrum is more about behavior than it is about process. Because you know that collaboration, exploration, interactions between people, you can't instruct that. You can impose the process of Scrum, but the real value in Scrum is how people behave within the process and not just the process itself. So Scrum is more about behavior than it is about process. And values drive behavior. Scrum defines 5 core values: commitment, focus, openness, respect, and courage. These values give direction to our work, behavior, and actions in Scrum. It does require us to understand these values against the complexity and unpredictability that Scrum enables us to address. Because we adopt Scrum because we are faced with unpredictability. We want to use the empiricism of Scrum. There's complexity, and that's how you should, that's a background from which you should translate the values. Now, in very short, the 5 values. So commitment is in line with its true meaning about dedication and dedication towards shared goals. It applies to the actions and the intensity of the efforts of all players, less than to exact and predicted output. Sort of assuming that most people remember that we said that long time ago in Scrum that by the end of sprint planning, a team would commit over sprint backlog and over the sprint. Commitment still meant that they said, honestly, at this point in time, by the end of the sprint planning, this is what we truly believe we can accomplish. And our commitment is to try to make this happen. Now, a lot of people not truly understanding Scrum, still thinking that we still live in the industrial age, translated that obviously as a hard-coded promise, a contract of whatever happens, this is what you will deliver because you have committed to that. And that is not commitment. Commitment means we will work really hard to make it happen within the boundary of sustainable pace. And we commit to keeping everybody updated if it doesn't happen or what does work for us and so on. So that's about the problems, the insights, the learnings and so on. That was commitment. So commitment has been skipped from, let's say, as a result of sprint planning, that has been replaced by forecast. but it is still an important value in Scrum because it means that we are dedicated to work hard, share lessons, share insights, and do the best we can. Now, focus, the next Scrum value, is increased through the balanced but distinct accountabilities of Scrum. All work in Scrum is time-boxed to encourage players to focus on what is imminent now, as the future is uncertain. So focus, we have three roles in Scrum. They have distinct accountabilities. They have to almost collaborate. Through the collaboration, they get beautiful results, but in those separation of concerns, they can still focus a lot on what they like to do. On top of that, we time box all work in Scrum because we want to create focus. We want to create some sort of positive tension in time. We don't have longer than a certain amount of time. That should help people focus on what is really important. What is really important now and not in 3 months' time. What is imminent now. That should help people realize that the future is always uncertain. So let's work with what we know now. Do everything we can to make that work. Openness. Openness relates more than to the transparency needed for empiricism, to the interactions and collaborative attitude of all players. Meaning players are open towards each other about their skills, also open about personalities, progress that they are making, or problems that they are encountering. So openness is more about the relationships and how people interact and relate to each other than just the transparency that is part of the empirical process. Respect is essential for self-organizing people collaborating towards shared ambitions. So we have all these beautiful people in those accountabilities working together, forming self-organizing units of, in a way, self-organizing people, and they work towards shared ambitions. Now, bringing all those often stubborn, expert, whatever people together and having them work towards shared ambitions, that requires quite some respect, because it requires respect for accountabilities and not taking over each other's accountabilities. It requires respect for honesty, so being honest. Respect for people's skills, what they know, what they do not know, the expertise they have or not have, diversity in personalities, in personal backgrounds, and so on, and differing opinions. Because all those people, they all think they know best, and it takes a lot of respect to work out their differences and strive and go for shared ambitions. Courage is needed to put quality first while embracing imperfection and turning change into a source of inspiration and innovation. And that's what people do through Scrum, the empiricism of Scrum, and the Scrum values. So courage is sort of a value that sort of glues everything in a way together, but all values are interrelated anyhow. So these values, these five values of Scrum, give direction to the decisions we take, the steps we take, the tactics we choose to play Scrum. What we do should reinforce these values, not diminish or undermine them. That's just one way of expressing the values in Scrum. That's what they're about, the five values. Now let's see how we can, in a way, use that in my story of engagement is the key. And what is sort of sometimes missing. Now, engagement is something I came up with, or I not rediscovered, but came on top of my mind again somewhere, I believe, a year and a half ago or so, when I was asked by a company in the Netherlands called Xibia. They have this beautiful magazine about agile stuff that they bring out, I think, 3 or 4 times a year. And they asked me to contribute an article with my thoughts and considerations over performance in an agile world. Now, everything I do is with regards to Scrum. So I thought about engagement in the world or performance in the world of Scrum. And then I came up, I remembered this report by Gallup. So it's an institute in the US. And every couple of years, they bring out reports, which they call the state of the global workplace. And the last one was from 2017, and that had data that they captured in the period of 2014 until 2016. Now, that was sort of scary. I remember, oh my God, that's right. They have this beautiful report saying that globally, so across the world, what they have found with all the companies and people that have answered their surveys and so on, they have found that across the world, just on average across the world, only 15% of people working for companies indicate or mention that they are truly engaged, meaning going for it, believing it, striving, working hard, really going completely for the company. And 67% of all people worldwide say, well, not really engaged. I translate this like sort of couldn't care less. I go to work, I hope I get my paycheck by the end of the month, and that's about it. Meaning that often translates into situations, I don't know whether you've ever run into that, like people entering the office in the morning. Sometimes they have to time or batch something or go through a little gate. And they often translate in a situation that they spend more time during the day watching their watch, hoping to go home as quickly as possible, and then do the stuff that they really love to do. So not really, sort of quite passive. Now, what is even worse is that across the world, on average, there's 18% of people indicating that they are actively disengaged. Meaning not just passively don't care, but actively, almost actively working against the company or working against us. So actively disengage. So not just passively disengage, but actively. That is scary. Now, I've got some rather good and even sort of better news. I'll come back to that. Now, most people, I'm assuming, are from Serbia. Maybe some people from Croatia or the wider region. The wider region in that report is called Eastern Europe. So Eastern Europe as a whole, and you see the green countries over there on the map, as a whole is sort of in line with the global averages. 15% really engaged, 69% couldn't care less, and 16% sort of actively disengaged. So it's slightly better than the world averages. But the good news is it seems that Serbia sticks out a little bit. In Serbia, the workforce, 22% of the workforce says that they're actively engaged. Wow, that's 7% more than the average of Eastern Europe. Only 60% not really engaged, and sort of the world average, 80% actively disengaged. Now, I would invite you to translate those figures a little bit to real numbers. That means that in a company of, let's say, 1,000 people, you have 220 people actively engaged working for the company. That means you have 600 people just sort of spending their time at the company, hoping that they will get paid by the end of the month. But you have 180 people almost up to the level of undoing the good work of those 22%. To help you out a little bit and give you hope, I'm from Belgium. I live in Antwerp in Belgium. And in Belgium, we are really bad. Overall, to start with, Western Europe is a lot worse than Eastern Europe. And look at the scale. Only Asia is worse than Western Europe. And in Belgium, we're sort of on top of the Western Europe average. So we only have 10%, 73%, and so on. Now, those are, in a way, scary figures. And I call it, I like to look at this as sort of, wow, we have a lot of room for improvement. Meaning in a Serbian company of 1,000 people, we can try to get 600 people, try to motivate them, and use Scrum and Agile to create a work environment that sort of engages them, so that they can fight the intrinsic motivation. In Belgium, we would have to try and reach out to 730 people out of every 1,000 people. So that's quite a lot. But I call it the untapped potential of humanization. So how about creating a more humane workplace so that people engage again with our companies? And that's what this is about. Engagement, in a way, is, so this is my representation of the Scrum values. So you recognize them, all five. So engagement is about commitment. It's almost a synonym. It's synonymous to that, but I like the word engagement more. I find it more inspiring, more positive. It's more about taking action. Committed is more like standing your ground. Engagement is more standing your ground and doing something with it. So engaging, it's more like an act. So engagement is about the Scrum value of commitment. So, like I just was reading in my my little text about the Scrum values, we have this past of commitment being wrongly interpreted, translated into a hard-coded contract. So this is the definition of commitment, so the state or quality of being dedicated to a cause, an activity, and so on, or a pledge or an undertaking. I like from the dictionary, the example of a trainer, that's the bottom statement, a trainer from a sports team saying, damn, we have lost the game, but I could not fault my players for their commitment. They worked hard, they tried everything, they adapted, they changed the strategy, we've switched some players. We didn't win, but we did everything in our power, in our means to try to win anyhow. Meaning we were fully committed, dedicated to winning, but it didn't work out this time. And that is the idea of commitment. And that was why commitment is a value in Scrum and less about committing to sprint backlog or a sprint by the end of sprint planning. So let me ask you a question first. So read this question. So I've got this little interactive tool for you. I'll quickly show you, but it's going to be based on the question, what is needed first and foremost to establish an environment of engagement and creativity? Because as you've seen, a lot of people are not really engaged for their companies, for their work, shared ambitions, and so on. So what can we do about it? What is needed to turn our companies into environments where people engage again? So let's try out a little bit of technology. Not my main thing, but still. So I'm going to share a new screen with you guys. So here's a way to, you see the question again, what is needed first and foremost to establish an environment of engagement and creativity? The lovely thing about this session is that I know that you're all online. So if you know this, you know what to do. I'm going to open the voting so we can all vote. If I find my mouse again. So let's see what happens. So if you get me technology. Ding, 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 ding. Okay, that's better. So I'm going to open the voting. You can enter up to 3 keywords. So go to menti.com. on your machine or whatever, that it will ask for a code. So you see the code over there. So what is needed first and foremost to establish an environment of engagement and creativity? And you can enter up to 3 keywords. So go. Nice, thank you. I hope you see the word cloud building up. Trust seems to be a very important one. I see stuff with safety, psychological safety, but not just psychological, but also physical safety, I believe. Trust, autonomy, openness. Respect, freedom. Goals, autonomy, often like things like empowerment come back, or mandate. Goals, relationships. Cool, thank you. Not to stress you out, but let's take 30 seconds and then closing the vote. You see the counter on the screen, I believe. You know, the power of time boxing quickly, that meant it so. So thank you very much. We've got 57 participants in the Zoom session, and we've got already 37 people have entered what they believe to be very important. Okay, cool. Thank you very much. That's great stuff on there. And most of them, if not all, are indeed very important. Vision, trust, respect, motivation, safety, goals, a shared language, like a lot, professionalism. Let me focus a little bit on one aspect. It's somewhere small. So let me go back to the PowerPoint again. So what is needed first and foremost? You've got all these beautiful things out there. Let me focus on this aspect first. An environment, just an environment. And there was one word in there that said a good workplace. And let me go into that first, because all the things you brought up, trust, empowerment, mandate, language and so on, indeed very important. But what I miss with most companies is a sort of inspiring environment. And let me share what that means. I don't know how work is organized in your region, but over here where I work, Belgium and the Netherlands, over the past, let's say, 10 years, everybody has evolved totally from those little cubicles towards open offices. So it's all open office environments. And I have no idea what you think of this situation. This is very quiet, very nice, very silent, but this is not engagement. Solving complex problems, creating difficult and complex things together requires communication, conversation, fighting out sort of over differing opinions and so on. This is not an environment that inspires people to really engage with each other. Just I invite you to sit still for the rest of the day, put your headphones on, and certainly not speak. I don't know whether you know the situation that I have to say something to a colleague who's like two seats away from me. And rather than just speaking up, I send him a text message or worse, a mail. That is not helpful. That creates information barriers rather than removing barriers. And then certainly on top of that, this clean desk policies, or in an agile context, I translate that into clean wall policies. Look at the cleanliness of the walls. Not helpful. You want to create an environment where people can actively collaborate, talk, have conversations, sort out stuff, do little design sessions on the wall, put stickers on the wall, talk about stuff. Now, a clean wall policy in an open office environment, not helpful for the sort of complex problems on which you want to apply Scrum. So, not helpful. Now, nowadays, we all have to work from home. That's even, I would almost say sometimes it's even worse. Yeah, we can focus for a while, but you know, we're human beings. We need the contact with other people. We need to bounce off ideas. Telework is probably even a worse implementation of a workplace than even worse than open offices. Open offices, great for office work, not great for creative cognitive work that requires your brains and bouncing off stuff against each other. So in a way, it doesn't look like that, but this is full of what I call disconnects. People are not really connected. So that's not sort of an environment that invokes a lot of engagement. It's not really inspiring. And that's sometimes a painful finding, because what we've gone through, we were, and probably still are not, but still we were not organized for complexity. So we had in our companies, we had this very traditional division of layers of labor and layers. In general, I don't know how that is in Serbia and the wider region, but in most companies I know, at least we used to have, and virtually mentally, we still have that sort of huge separation between business and IT. And they're more like behaving each other's enemies rather than working together. And then we try to solve that by having governance that says who should be talking to who, at what point in time, or what handover should happen, what signals should be put on what sort of documents and so on. Very slow, very rigid, so not agile at all. And then on top of that, management and so on. And we used to have a lot of individuals running around in organizations. What I always say, sort of like headless chickens. Sort of, this is disconnectedness. And people find out, wow, to survive, and not just to survive, but to prosper, to become a really great company in today's world with all of the complexity that we're facing, all of the change, that these structures are not working. So a lot of people quickly say, oh yeah, that's fine. We've got the beautiful solution for them. We need an agile transformation. We need to become an agile organization. And what do? They try to become an agile organization by using sort of old recipes, what I call cookbook recipes. They copy what other companies do. They blindly implement some sort of predictive solution or a solution that seems to be working at other companies. I know several years ago, the Spotify thing was a really hype around in Belgium and the Netherlands, was sort of inspired by ING, the big orange bank. And people were just blindly copying that too. They, over a short period of time, they compose all of the sort of headless chickens running around people. And they now have to be part of some sort of team. They call them agile team. They all have to work on the same sprint length without further considering that. Scrum teams are established within existing silos of companies. They all have to apply the same practices. And that's sort of an industrial way to become agile, not working. So what happens? For a while, and that's often 2 to 3 years in time, companies for themselves build up the idea that they are becoming more agile, that their agility is increasing, until often they've been applying the wrong recipes, whatever, mass production, industrial recipes. And after a while, they have this sort of hard wake-up call, which I call the deflation by reality, because they had building up the illusion of agility, an illusion that they were becoming more agile. At some point in time, the bubble bursts and the deflation by reality happens, and they fall flat on their feet and on their backs again. That means they find out they are not quicker on the market, their time to market has not improved, their customer satisfaction has not improved, their team engagement or their people, their staff engagement has not improved, meaning great people still leave the company, and they have a lot of difficulties in attracting bright, new, intelligent, creative people. So that's the deflation by reality. And it's just because they apply the wrong recipes. Agile, or introducing Scrum to make it more tangible in my world, you should implement or adopt or introduce Scrum using Scrum in a way, meaning iteratively, incrementally, step by step by step. That is a lot of hard work. It's quite unpredictable, but that's the nature of a transformation. But a lot of companies seem to want to avoid the hard work, spend energy, build up their own lessons and their own learnings. No, rather quickly copy paste what other people do, get all their teams to apply the same practices, establish them within existing silos. And that's often not helpful. And it's often even worse because they keep combining it with the fact that teams do not have a team space. And I just talked about engagement. One of the things I see missing to really inspire people to engage is the fact that they don't have team spaces, that they can organize, that they can put things on the wall, that they can speak up with each other, that they can share stuff. So a lack of team spaces. So they want to go for Agile and they don't have team spaces. That is impossible because Agile and Scrum are very team-centric approaches. It's about combining skills and expertise and then focus on shared objectives. You will not have that sort of energy and engagement in an open office environment. And then next to that, the old school problems of team instability, meaning no dedicated teams. People outside of the teams, external to the teams, think that they know better who should be part of what team or what project at what point in time. So when I look back at some experiences I had with companies, even the best or the highest or the most collaborative teams often went down again because people couldn't stop intervening in the team composition. Oh yeah, you now have to be the product owner of that project. And you now, senior developer, whatever, have to go solve problems or save that other team. And every time the fluid system that they've been building, the well-oiled system, is broken apart again. And that doesn't help people to really engage, and motivation goes down again every time. Because every time they build something up and it's being disrupted again. Or meeting culture. People are being tracked to all sorts of meetings all of the time. Nowadays, by the way, with all of the virus stuff, with all of the telework, people are sort of experiencing in a sort of very hard way how much meetings we actually have in companies. Because they now have to attend all those meetings via Zoom or whatever tools people use. And that's sort of very confrontational because it confronts them with how much meetings they actually are expected to attend. And then on top of that, all those companies want to become more agile, but they still keep imposing delivery and deadlines on teams rather than helping a team explore what is actually possible. And one of the worst things is that using Scrum or Agile as an excuse to fire people. So this is sort of brings us into the domain of catastrophe. And by the end, the deflation by reality. Now that is sort of painful. And it just brings up the idea again that I've been sharing with companies. You know what? Just having all those individuals and then put those individuals into agile, whatever you call agile teams, that does not make your organization a more agile organization. It's not by moving individuals into teams and keeping all those structures and silos and disconnected things in place on top of working in an open office environment, that will not make your company more flexible, adaptive, resilient, fluid, able to deal with changes in the world. It requires a little bit more. More agile teams does not make a more agile organization. In the context of what we're talking about, just putting people into teams, imposing a lot of agile rules on them and practices and sprint lengths and so on, is not going to invoke engagement. It's not going to make people feel like they now own their own work. So that's not helpful. And I'm sort of astonished by that when I work with organizations, because I run into quite some people that have read my book and that are enthusiastic about my book, luckily excited. And then I point out to them, yeah, but you know, let's look around in the company. You've got all these open offices. Where are the team spaces? What do you mean team spaces? Well, you know, in that little book I wrote a few years ago, I've mentioned something what I call the Scrum Game Board. And the ambition I had with the Scrum Game Board was not just to mention the official elements of Scrum. You will still find them. At the heart of Scrum, you will find the valuable increment. You will find the two other artifacts, product backlog and sprint backlog. Also highlighting that you have to manage those two artifacts with progress and trends and so on, burnout charts, whatever you want to use, and visualize your progress, measure progress. The three roles of Scrum, sort of the three main activities of Scrum, so that sprints are being planned, replanned on a daily basis, and by the end of the sprint, we're going to look back, we're going to reflect on the sprint and take into account lessons on what we have built and how we have built that. So I've combined that into sprint reflections. But I also wanted to point out what I consider important principles underlying Scrum. And that starts with what I call a shared visual workspace. Teams, Scrum teams, development teams need their own workspace. And if it's not a physical workspace because they have to work remotely or distributedly like we have now all have to do, they still need a virtual workspace. But they need a workspace that they can control, that they can manage, that they can use, that they can decorate, in which they can use information radiators and so on. That is essential to teamwork. Otherwise, you create delays and waste again in sharing information. And on top of that, the two other principles, and that's what I call Scrum's DNA, is Scrum is based upon self-organization, the capability of people to organize their own work within the boundaries of Scrum, the top things, and empiricism, regularly inspecting so that you can adapt. And that's our beautiful alternative, let's say, to the old school phase gates and so on. So, but anyhow, as part of this story, it was about a shared visual workspace. Another way of representing that in my book was what I called the house of Scrum. So you want to create a sort of house of Scrum, a zone, virtually a house, a zone in which your Scrum teams operate. And at the external of your Scrum zone is about inspection adaptation, based upon the foundation of transparency. If you don't have full transparency, you can't properly inspect and adapt. And it's ultimately up to the goal of regularly producing increments. And what you do within the house of Scrum for that, you create stuff, you create that increment, you work together based upon those principles, the Scrum's DNA, the core rules of Scrum, but also the Scrum values and applying tactics. So you need a house of Scrum if you want to properly do Scrum. Now, that house of Scrum, that allows people to have focus, the focus I just explained. So we want to invoke engagement. That means we have to create environments where people can have a focus again, a focus on collaborating, a focus on getting stuff done, a focus that allows them to not go to meetings, that allows them to not having to send a text message if I have to ask a colleague, a team member that is only like three chairs away from me. So you need to create focus. And that's what a Scrum zone is about. Now, focus within that Scrum zone means the following. So the illusion of agility in terms of Scrum, you know the idea of inspection and adaptation. So inspection is just the start. So my overall observation, my inspection, let's say, of a lot of, if not most or all agile transformations is that they're stuck in building up an illusion of agility. And it's just a matter of time before they will deflate and find out that they have not achieved what they wanted to achieve. Now, that's only the inspection. It's about what do you do with that? What's your adaptation? And what I believe in, and what I've been suggesting to companies is, hey, let's reimagine your Scrum. So you have established Scrum teams, but within existing silos, still under layers of governance. Or you've abused Scrum for firing all of the middle management, which leaves all those poor teams without any form of coordination. Let's go back, and rather than try to reorganize a full company overnight, let's go back and make it small. Let's look at one product that you're using Scrum on, or some other meaningful initiative, but preferably a very clear bounded product. If your product is really big, you might want to slice it and use that to do the following: to upgrade your Scrum or reimagine your Scrum for that initiative, preferably that product. Looking back at how does your product backlog look like? Is it actually the single plan you have, the single source of truth? Let's look at the accountabilities you have in place. Let's make sure that those people are dedicated to that product and not have to multitask across several products or projects at the same time. Let's make sure that they have a proper team zone, a Scrum zone, within which they have the tools, the infrastructure, the authorizations to do their job. And let's leave them alone. So create a Scrum zone for a product, one product, and let's sort of do Scrum properly. But we're not going to do it for the full company, just one product. So slice it if possibly, and I make sure that for that one product, we can move towards creating what we call sashimi releases, small, functional, tasty, nice, tasteful releases. True, and that's also part of the tools and infrastructure, a controlled and preferably automated deployment pipeline. Let's do that for one product only, and then sort of upgrade, uplift the way you've been doing Scrum. So that resource-focused, dedicated people, that overcomes a lot of the negative observations I had on a lot of agile transformations. Now, those people you assemble might come from different departments. So if you establish all those teams in your silos, now suddenly we're going to have probably need people from different silos. And that will get us into sort of conflict with managers, team leads, and so on. But that's what we need to go through. And then repeat this, keep repeating that. So keep expanding that initiative, but also do the same for a next initiative. Grow in the next initiative, and so on, until in the end, you've transformed your complete organization, step by step by step. And if you would have done this as from the start, you would not have built up that illusion of agility. It would have been the hard work with falling back, being pulled back, getting up again, falling down, getting up, recovering, healing, doing stuff better. That's just part of life. That's how it's supposed to be, almost. And then if you would look at 2-3 years time, you would have done this. It would have taken you a lot farther than blindly copying what other people do, making everybody follow the same practices and so on. So inspection, illusion of agility, adaptation, reimagining your Scrum. And it's sort of driven by the Scrum values. It's about invoking engagement, commitment, making sure that people can focus again, meaning focus on doing valuable work, not losing time, context switching and task switching and project switching, not losing time having to attend tons and tons of external meetings. No, rather be dedicated on this type of work. Now, this type of work will include conflict. So I've indicated some sort of levels of conflict. Now, what you will see in the open office environment, and often with a lot of teams, that there's this sense of what I call complete harmony, very peaceful. Peaceful in the sense that nobody's speaking up, nobody's sharing ideas, nobody's fighting over ideas in a positive way. That is not helpful. It's not what we look for. Solving complex problems requires communication, interaction, people bringing up tons of ideas and options on the table. And as a team, sorting out what are we going to do. So looking for commitment, consensus, moving forward. We need that. So the level of conflict that we need is what is called productive dissent. So in a productive way, in a positive, constructive way, solving our differences, the different opinions that we have. So absence of conflict, meaning complete harmony, is detrimental to progress and performance, not helpful. Now, obviously, conflict escalating into a personal war, a war within the team, or teams within the teams that start fighting each other over ideas, that's probably also not what you want. Preferred level of conflict is sort of productive dissent. People discussing ideas, options, while respecting each other's skills, background, personal life, professional experience, and so on. That is important. So respect is important in a productive dissent level. Also, what I call the openness. So it's about commitment. How can we create environments that people can commit? And commitment and engagement have a lot to do with intrinsic motivation. At least give them an environment where they can have a focus again on valuable work, on work that they like to do for themselves, in a way that they can be very open, that they can share ideas, that they can struggle with ideas, that they can fall, get back up. And that's also a lot of those words in that word cloud were about safety, psychological safety at least. Safety means an environment where you can safely speak up, speak your mind, and not being disrespected, not being bashed for it, but people listening to you and then fighting over other forms of ideas. That is openness. So conflict is natural and even needed as long as it doesn't escalate into sort of unhealthy levels. Now, reimagine your scrum. There's often some additional challenges, sort of like when you see the illusion of agility and then the additional points. If you do this for that one product, once you start for that, there's a lot of additional fixing that needs to happen. So let's say you're reimagining your scrum, doing it properly, even if it's only at a team level, you will run into higher up challenges. Meaning, how does funding now work? How do we deal with financing our stuff? Or what people traditionally call resource allocation. Oh, we want to have dedicated people in our development teams that are dedicated on this product and not 2 days in a week over there and another day in a week over there and then still over there. No, full-time on this, or as full-time as possible, at least on this product. You will get into troubles with HR procedures on how to assess people, how to review people. That's also the idea of performance, right? With product management people, you know, this situation where often sales or commercial people almost claim the customer or the users for themselves and not allowing anybody in there, you will run into that if you want to have a real product owner, really owning the product. So a lot of things that you need to fix, and I prefer fixing those things for one product at the same time and not for 100 teams at the same point in time. It's never going to work. It scales. You will think you're working it out, but it's an illusion. Step by step by step. So making it small again and then going for the real stuff.
Sorry, but that is an answer. We continue. I think we have an interesting question in this regard.
Yeah, cool. Go ahead.
Do you want, James, to get it off?
Sure, I can. Or we can delay it. So whatever you want to do, Gunther. I had two questions. The first was, when you want to establish an effective, I think you called it team zone, right? Mm-hmm. Which goes back to caves and commons type approach. I have found that when it's a new pilot effort, I can generally take over a meeting room forever, or I can go find an empty, I remember finding an empty room on old unutilized factory floor, and we went and moved in there, you know, kind of intentionally isolated ourselves.
Cool.
And that works, you know.
Yes.
But then I've been at companies where as you start to expand, you're working with a division that has a few thousand people in it, and the people that do facilities, well, they're like in a whole nother building, you know, many buildings away on the campus in their own little silo. And even what the senior VP in your own division thinks, even if he has to write the check for it, right, has almost very little influence of the cookie cutter facilities people, right?
Yeah.
So the question was, any insight, thoughts around that? And then I also had one on the HR.
You've just, James, almost perfectly described the difficulty of the challenge.
Yeah.
So what it requires, a lot of courage from Scrum Masters or coaches to bring this topic up with management, the people that sort of control the money, and bring this up as a real problem. And that's really difficult. I remember, like, I loved what you just described. I remember a long time ago, back in 2003, the first time I got into this world of HR and Scrum and so on. We started with a project in extreme programming. And our management allowed us to sort of indefinitely occupy a meeting room, like you just described.
With windows, you hope, because otherwise terrible.
Yes, it had windows, yeah. And it was sort of a crisis feeling, project endangered and so on, so we moved it to extreme programming. We also got it back on track, but the crisis feeling was big enough so that we could occupy that meeting room. And that is still a very vivid memory for me, because I remember it also had glass walls towards the interior of the building. And I remember people walking by and looking at us in our little fishbowl and thinking, oh my God, what sort of anarchy, what sort of chaos is it in there? Because from the outside, we did pair programming, we did test-driven development, we did a lot of things. And it seems like from the outside, it was just chaos. People talking, whatever, sorting things, going to the wall, sorting things. But it was amazingly performant from the inside. So if you were part of it, you felt like, wow, this is full of energy. People also went home on a normal time of day because we were exhausted. But we were exhausted in a positive way. We felt every day we felt like we were making a difference. So that was huge. And then let me sort of go to the sort of the extreme other side of the spectrum. And the last company I worked with was about a year ago. They had all these open offices. So it's a huge insurance company in the Netherlands. And at some point in time, I was working with teams and figuring out what is not working. This is not working. Something's not working. We've been in sprint plannings. First of all, the time box is sprint plannings way too short. So we never get around to talking about the real stuff. But and then it dawned on me, oh damn, the fact is, the problem is, as sort of five whys brought me there, it starts with the fact that they don't have a team space. So they have to organize all their events in meeting rooms. So they have to book meeting rooms 3 months ahead of time. Otherwise, they don't have a meeting room. They can only block a meeting room for, like, say, maybe 1 hour, maybe at most 2 hours. And then most of the time, it's 1 hour. So we have in sprint planning, only 1 hour. Even for a sprint of 2 weeks, that's quite short. And by the end of that 1 hour, people having great conversations, talking about stuff. What happens? People knock at the door. Please leave the room. It's now our room. And instead of continuing the conversation somewhere else, it's just, meeting's over, we have to stop. So that is awful. So I brought it up I was connected to the top management, CXO level. I brought it up as a real problem. Yeah, but, you know, and so on. And then you end up with a situation that a lot of those transformations of the workplace from silos or cubicles to open offices, it's all decisions in which the workforce themselves are not consulted. It is decided for them. And that's a problem. And then you have all those things that people, only the mere fact that you have to do a Scrum event in a meeting room makes it a meeting. and not an event. And that's already a problem. So I don't have a medical solution, so I brought it up. I pointed out to people what that means for performance, for the chaotic sprints that they're going through, not having team space and so on. I'm getting used to people not hiring me for my advice and then not taking my advice seriously. So yeah, I don't have a solution that except for pointing out the problems over and over again. But in the end, you get this sort of, you leave this sort of impression of always nagging. And yeah.
I have one answer that I've never seen executed, mm-hmm. which is in a different context. Someone was saying, well, the way that you get people to stop distributing a team halfway around the world is that you build a costing model that accounts for the amount of time that people on one end are spending handholding, you know, the amount of additional yeah. communication bandwidth and the slowdown that happens. And once you get that costing model, then you show it to the bean counter and the bean counter goes, oh, well, it really is that much more expensive. I didn't realize that. But as long as the only parameters in their model are you know, headcount cost and simple things that don't map back to the, yeah. the overall, the argument was that by presenting a different costing model to people that are driven by the financial metrics, that you tend to get a different answer. Now, I've never seen that succeed,
yeah.
but I could, because I think people do what they emotionally want to do and do it anyway, half the time. But perhaps that might work here, because agile teams, they take more space per head, right? The buildouts are more expensive. It's just that who cares, because the humans are what are costing you all the real money.
Yeah, I've had that effect sometimes by trying to represent the cost of context switching and task switching to help people, allow us to have dedicated people in teams rather than having to spend. But often, even the last company I worked with, even the CIO, the organization of the office was beyond his control. It was like facilities had decided and logistics departments and so on. And that's sort of it.
This is Himadri Gantha. I just have one small question. The entire Scrum guide itself is the rule book for Scrum.
Mm-hmm.
So if I try to find out any principles word in the Scrum rule book, then the principles is not mentioned. So which are the things which we take account as part of Scrum principle?
It's stuff I wanted to add to my Scrum game board to make them more present in people's mind. That Scrum is built on the idea of empiricism, inspection, adaptation. So even all of the events serve that idea of inspection, adaptation. That is sort of in the Scrum guide, but I like to emphasize it a lot. But also the idea of self-organizing people and self-organization requires a zone for ourselves. So it takes thinking a little bit deeper about Scrum and not looking at sort of the superficial, let's say, practices. Oh yeah, we now do sprint planning and we have a daily Scrum every day. Where are the results? Well, there's more to just doing, getting results out of Scrum. So they're actually, for me, they are in the Scrum guide, but not sort of, can I say that? Not sort of in your face, more in an implicit way. And I wanted to make that more explicit. Does that help?
Yeah. Thanks, Gante.
Okay, you're welcome. Yeah, okay. Shall we move on? Bogdan, we're okay?
Okay.
All right, cool. Well, thanks. So thank you, James, and the other things. Now, this idea of the question mark. So what is more agile teams does not make a more agile organization. That means we need to do more. Now, the fascinating thing is, certainly in the Scrum world, we go back to the paper called The New Product Development Game a lot. I'm sort of hoping that at least some people know it. I've referenced it in my book also, make a little thing. Now, The New Product Development Game, a paper from 1986, where Ken and Jeff, with the help of other people, got some ideas and principles from, and also the name Scrum, because you know Scrum refers to the game of rugby. That was brought up in that paper, The New Product Development Game. So the New Product Development Game, team, sports, focused a lot on working as a team. Now, adopting that new way of working, they said in the New Product Development Game that also organizations also need to adopt a new management style. A management style that promotes this process. They didn't elaborate on it. We don't do that with Scrum either, but it's simple. You cannot introduce Scrum without impacting an existing organization. We don't say from Scrum. So you won't find in the Scrum guide anything that says how you should reorganize around Scrum, but you cannot properly introduce Scrum without touching the existing environment. It seems a lot of people have that illusion, which then contributes to building up the illusion of agility. So, and this is from the New Product Development Game. So two Japanese professors, and they identified six main characteristics that are, that they found in research. Those characteristics were common to companies that were more successful in building new products, creating and sustaining new products. And those new products in 1986, by the way, had nothing to do with IT and software. It was about cars, photocopiers, laser printers, and so on. Companies like Honda, Xerox, Fujitsu, and so on. And those two Japanese professors had documented the results of their research, and they found that the organizations that have these six characteristics built into the way that they work with teams are more successful. So building instability, you recognize self-organizing teams, multi-learning. Fascinating thing, it was more about not just cross-functional teams, but also cross-fertilizing teams. So people learning skills from each other, and people not mastering a certain skill can bring in a very fresh perspective to that skill, by the way. But in the context of this, I want to focus on these two. First of all, they describe what they call overlapping development phases. Now in Scrum, the way we know Scrum, we take it a step further. It's not just overlapping development phases. We do all of development work in one sprint. But those professors already said that companies that are more successful in creating new products, doing complex and new creative work like we do with every software development project, they need to organize their people in teams, having all those different disciplines and personalities, and they should work as a unit in a shared workspace. So even in the one of the roots that we based on, that Scrum is rooted in this paper, 1986, already said you need a shared workspace to get the most out of teamwork. And the other thing is that we know, obviously, self-organization. And it's not just self-organization. Why I wanted to highlight this is, remember the question marks, more agile teams does not make a more agile organization. You need to do something more. This is a perfect summary of what you want an organization to behave towards Scrum teams. The organization funds the teams. They give them money. They give them support. They give them environment. But they allow them to act like startups, thriving on autonomy, self-transcendence, and not just cross-functional composition, but cross-fertilization. So that means give them money, follow them up via the development phases and so on, but do not intervene in their daily work. That's sort of the essential message. And that is the new management style that we're looking for. The management style that we're looking for is a shift from moving from managing people towards managing an environment, creating an environment in which people can self-organize and cross-fertilize and multi-learn and so on. So it was already set in 1986, imagine. Now, talking about those two aspects of the DNA of scrum, so we know about empiricism, inspection, adaptation. Let's go into, that's sort of the one aspect of scrum that a lot of organizations are getting to get or to grasp. They're learning that. It's all about inspection, adaptation. Now, the idea, the other aspect of Scrum's DNA, self-organization, seems to be a bit more difficult. And that's why is that? In my view, my observation, because it's a lot attached to working with people. Inspection adaptation is sort of process thing, sort of technically, can I say that more? Well, this is about working with people, meaning human beings, not replaceable pieces of machinery, not robots, not cogs in some sort of machine, human beings. Now, Scrum thrives on what I just said, self-organization. Now, self-organization is not a clearly defined term, which is good, because that means we have to give it meaning ourselves. Now, what I've tried to indicate here is, you will not get any benefits from Scrum in the bottom thing, a manager-led or a manager-centric or a team lead-centric way of working. You will not get any value out of bringing together 10 people where there's one person continuously saying who should be working on that, mining the quality, project manager-wise, and so on. So manager-led is not helpful in Scrum. You might just stop doing Scrum again. The minimal level of self-organization in Scrum is what I've called self-managing, a self-managing team. Meaning, if managers, stakeholders, whatever, have an interest in some sort of Scrum development, they should manage the boundaries, create an environment, facilitate those teams, fund them, allow them to act as startups, meaning in Scrum terms, go to sprint reviews when you're invited by the product owner. In other words, just work with the product owner, but leave the team, have their focus on getting stuff done. So that's the minimal level of self-management. Now, if we're going to ask for dedicated teams, for me that translates into the next level of self-organization, meaning teams can be self-designing. Meaning we will stop pulling people out of teams and putting them in other teams. If teams feel they need additional or new skills or better skills or whatever, they will ask for it. They need to ask for it. They need to design themselves towards optimizing for the work that they're entitled or that they're expected to do. And when they need new skills, new people, new talents, other expertise, whatever, we will help them, we will support them, we will facilitate them in hiring and looking for those people themselves. They can design themselves. It's also a way to look at team size, because we all know that the Scrum Guide says 3 to 9 people in the development team. My view is nice. It's a guideline. It's guidance from the Scrum Guide. It's not a hard-coded law. It's up to the teams themselves to look for the right size to do their work. That might mean that in a development team of 10 people, which is beyond 9, a team might still consciously decide to keep working as 10 people, because splitting up in several teams has other effects. There's additional overhead, there's additional communication, integration, interaction needed. They might decide not to do that, or they might try to experiment with it, go back as well. So in a truly self-organizing setup for a team, they would design their own size, their own skills. The most difficult aspect of that is that means that the development team in Scrum is in only a development team is entitled to get somebody out of the team. Nobody needs to do that for them. We can facilitate, we can help them. Self-designing means that the team decides not to work with, not to have a person be part of the team anymore, for whatever reason. We help them solve conflicts and so on, but if it really not work, it's up to the team. So that's self-designing. So most organizations are still having troubles with just self-managing teams. That's what I just said in the illusion of agility, a lack of team stability. That means resource managers, project managers, team leads, department heads, and so on, they all pull out people from teams and assign them to other teams. That's not helpful in motivating people and invoking engagement. So let's allow teams to be self-designing. And all those aspects, from management towards teams, in allowing self-organization to play, in allowing teams to design themselves, do their work in a sprint, and go visit at the sprint review. And don't visit the sprint review to judge them and have them justify what they've done or not have done. But help them do better. Help them organize the next sprint in a better way. Help them realign on priorities and strategic changes and so on. That is an incredible form of respect from the organization to
Gunther,
your scrum.
James again. What's your thoughts on should a young team be allowed to self-design?
Yeah, of course. Every single human being can think about their work and how to do that. And let's happen. By the end of every sprint, in general, throughout the world, for whatever reason, there's another virus going around, and that says that you have to do sprints of 2 weeks. So every 2 weeks, by the end of every 2 weeks, you have a sprint retrospective to help the team look back at any decision that they've taken on team size, on available skills, on expertise, on the tools that they have access to or not.
Okay.
So every 2 weeks, there's a great point to look back and help them grow, evolve, and take revise or take better decisions.
So I find that for all the measures that you mentioned, I fully agree. And I find that it is very useful if, you know, you have a product and you have what's likely to be multiple teams on the product to allow the teams to self-organize, or I think you self-design is the word you would use.
Mm-hmm.
What I find is problematic is sometimes I will see people that are very new to Scrum start to try to adapt Scrum itself before they have a clue why things are what they are. And so some of the adaptations, if the team had been running for 2 years and they said they wanted to do that and they were actively producing value and gelled together and they said, I'd be sure, whatever. Maybe you're right. I don't even care if it's Scrum. I care that, you know, they know what they're doing. Yep. When they're new enough at it, it's like a child who's just learning to walk saying, I'm going to go drive the car. And
yep.
I'm not sure they're ready for it yet.
Yep.
So that's where I was...
I absolutely agree. So that's why we have the boundaries of Scrum, the rules of the game, the self-management, and all the changes you do are within those boundaries. That's another misunderstanding of self-organization. Self-organization does not mean do whatever you want. Self-organization happens within boundaries. There needs to be some constraints. That's why we do the time boxes in Scrum. And that's why, yeah, you do it within the rules of the game. Yeah.
So within your pyramid, when would a team become so proficient as to be allowed to even change the rules of the game, right? Well, at self-directing level?
It all depends a bit on what you call changing the rules of the game. It will still require some reflection regularly to look back at that changes. Are they working for us? Are we still? So the core idea of inspection adaptation should always be there, and reflecting by the end of every sprint, looking back on certain decisions, the impacts for better or for worse, that at least should always be there.
Okay,
and that's,
I think
that's
I have
the minimal rule of the game now. Yeah,
I think I have clarity of understanding, and I think you and I are very much aligned. I'm just not quite sure how it maps to the thought model that you have described. That's the delta.
Well, maybe for the time being, let's just say don't change the rules of the game. Just play.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm totally fine with that. And anything else that happens, you can't sort of document that or prescribe or describe what's going to happen. Just, I like also acting in the moment, just as it happens. Don't try to sort of foresee things. In the meantime, just play by the rules, and the rules are on the game board.
Okay, sorry, Gunther, we have another one coming up. So from Skodorovsky. So any advice on how to act in situation where the Scrum Masters have done good job and the teams are self-organized, designed, and high-performing, and management decides to let go most of the Scrum Masters?
Yeah, there's this strange thing. So over the past 5-6 years, in the area where I work the most in the Netherlands, I've been doing a lot of scrums, and that they had to give it different names, and it became DevOps and whatever. And Scrum Masters suddenly, or not suddenly, gradually became highly undervalued, up to the level that they've been letting go of Scrum Masters, and it became a sort of side job a little bit for somebody from the team. If you have some time left over, then you're also a Scrum Master. So my profound belief and observation is that you always need a Scrum Master. The ultimate goal of a Scrum Master is what I've called at some point in time, to become invisibly present. Meaning you're there, you have at most always a sort of comforting presence. You're there, you're not intervening, you're mentoring, you have a comforting presence, you're observing. How can you observe and potentially indirectly share observations if you're not there? So the ultimate thing for a Scrum Master is to be invisibly present. The analogy that I often make to people when people come up to me to ask them, yeah, but when is the point that the Scrum Master becomes obsolete, because that is self-organization, right? The self-organizing team. I said, well, you know what? I wonder myself every year again when I go out in the garden, when will be the time that my garden will no longer need me as a gardener? Because they know how to grow those plants. They've been doing for millions of years. But you know, my garden is a lot more beautiful with somebody taking care of it, caring for it, helping it, aligning it. There will always be turbulences, disturbances and so on, like weather changes, seasonal changes. There will always be changes within the organization, beyond an organization, market, businesses, strategic stuff, team changes, new insights. There is always some change that teams need facilitating. Always. So the ultimate goal for a Scrum Master is to become invisibly present, but even that, there's always enough disturbances and turbulences that a team, in order to focus on their accountability, that they want to leave in the hands of somebody else, meaning a Scrum Master. And in the Netherlands, certainly over the past 1 or 2 years, there's been a really revived interest in the Scrum Master role. And why is that? Exactly because of a lot of problems don't get addressed anymore. Things don't get tackled anymore. And they come up to people like me, Scrum Master coaching, asking, yeah, but what should we do with that? Oh, beautiful. We have a role for that in Scrum. Oh, yeah, right. Scrum Master. We don't have a Scrum Master anymore. Maybe that's a good thing then to have a Scrum Master for. So the idea of self-organization is not self-organization happens within boundaries, within the rules of the game, respecting the rules of the game. And you need people helping teams discover when they are crossing boundaries and how to get more out of their work while they are focusing on their work. So that sort of an abuse by managers, abuse of the term self-organization to skip a quite crucial part of Scrum.
So Gunther, mentioning boundaries, another question. How and which boundaries apply when a department is willing to allow mass self-organization? Where teams can form around the different pieces of work themselves? Is it advisable? By mass self-organization, self-design of initial teams of around, let's say, 100 people.
Well, what I miss in most agile transformations or companies adopting Scrum for whatever reason is that they don't think about product. They just set up Scrum teams within existing structures. Nobody thinks about sort of what I call the scope of your Scrum should be product, because you have a product owner, a product backlog, and you want to create releasable increments of product. And that is important, product, providing end-to-end value to the consumers of your product so that you can have an impact on your market. Now, most companies don't go through that. So if even in that mass self-organizing context, self-organization requires boundaries. So even if 100 people, 100 teams, whatever want to now self-organize, they need direction. What's the direction that we need to go through? So the idea of having a product and even potentially a product owner, being able to describe to those people, yeah, this is the product that we want to build. These are some of the problems we had in the past with the silos and I don't know, low quality, whatever. This is what we want to solve. We want to have an impact on our market. This is one of the boundaries. Organize yourselves into one or multiple teams so that we can better service that product and better via that product service our consumers. It's something I miss. The concept, the identification, the definition of what is our product so that we know what is, oh, what is the focus and transparency of product backlog and product owner. So product for me is quite essential. Was that helpful?
We got a yes.
Okay, cool. And there were, I've seen organizations that are self-organizing, allowing people to self-design them into teams, but it always started with product. They could apply or sign up to be part of the team for certain products. But just products gives so much additional transparency. So that's for me very important and unfortunately missing in most companies. Yeah. Now about that respect again. So in 2014, I was working with Ken Schwaber, Scrum the Top. We created something that we called Agility Path. And it was exactly about helping management make a shift. Shifting away from breathing down the neck of teams, looking at the performance of teams. By the way, I don't buy into the term high-performing teams too much. I like highly collaborative teams a lot more. For me, performance is sort of part of the old world. If I have highly collaborative teams, they will produce great results, certainly given the boundaries of Scrum. So we wanted to help management shift away, move away from breathing down the neck of teams and thinking about what is the impact of the work that those teams are doing that we have at a sort of organizational level. Meaning value. What is the value that teams are producing? Yeah. So rather than focusing on how the Scrum Zone internally is performing, look at the external effect, the outcomes of the work of the team zones on the market with users and so on. And just one way to sort of reflect that shift is that sprint reviews at least should no longer revolve around the question, did everybody in this team, every individual, did you all do your work throughout the sprint? And did you deliver at did you deliver the velocity that we were expecting? Sort of individuals, teams, tasks, estimates, velocity, and so on. That is looking at the performance even within the teams. So print reviews should be, from a stakeholder perspective, should revolve around the question, start with the question, how much potential, but how much value, not tasks, not estimates, how much value has this team, not the individual, but the team as a whole, created throughout this sprint, not a daily basis? And that seems to be a huge shift from tasks to value, from individuals to teams, from estimates to sprints. And that should be the idea. And we've tried to create something we call the Agility Path and try to help people focus on value. And let me show that to you. So we identified as part of Agility Path. It's now called EBM, by the way, by Scrum the Top. What we called key value indicators. By then we organized them in three key value areas. This idea that we have in companies, KPIs, key performance indicators. Not working because they're abused, with key performance indicators in itself is nothing wrong, but people turn them into objectives rather than measurements and indicators of situations. So that sort of my creativity ends at the level of saying, oh, key performance indicators, let's make that key value indicators. So from KPIs to KVIs, sort of where my creativity sort of stopped. And at the highest level, again, there's something about value. In IBM, it's officially called current value. Now, if in classes, sessions, workshops, coaching, engagements, consulting engagements, whatever, if I ask people about value, people always bring up something with money, benefit, profit, something financial, financial return, whatever, and something with customers. Let's say briefly, something with customer satisfaction, happy customers, whatever. Now, I also believe that value, like I said earlier on, should not just be about the organization via stakeholders and money, not just customers via more happy customers, more market share as well, but also what we do with Scrum should also bring value to the teams, which is reflected in something that I call, here we are again, team engagement. How engaged are the teams? How committed are they to the organization, to the product, to the rest of the team? Because how helpful is it if you have a high profit product with happy customers, but very unhappy teams where your best people leave the company all the time, you can't find new people, you can't replace them and so on. Not helpful. You want to have a combination of at least of those three. And even more, remember the title of this thing is called Engagement is the Key. So from those three, the one that is ignored the most should be on the top of your list. And even forgetting about the other ones. Remember, employees who are engaged, and that's actually only 15% of our work staff, 22% in Serbia, actually care a lot more about team, customer, and enterprise outcomes. So if only in a company of 1,000 people, if only 150 people actually care, what if we could double that? What if we could make that 15% into 30%? And 15% more. What if you can engage 300 people on top of those 150 people? That would be quite amazing. And they will care a lot more about the financial returns and about the customer satisfaction. So we are focusing on the wrong aspects. Individual performance and performance in terms of money, customer satisfaction, and so on. It's about the teams and team engagement. And by the way, that was also shown in that study by Gallup. Engagement is the key because they have found, so they had three areas, engaged people, passive people, not engaged, or actively disengaged people. Now they've been looking into metrics, measurements, performance indicators, whatever, of companies that were in the higher areas where, relatively more people were engaged than in other companies. And they found that in those companies, their customer metrics, customer satisfaction were 10% higher. Productivity, the ability to create stuff was higher. Sales were higher, profitability were higher. So the positive metrics were actually a lot higher. And the negative things, so there was less turnover, meaning staff turnover. There was less people leaving the company. Absenteeism was a lot lower. So that's quite amazing. So engagement actually is the key. So focus on team engagement, create an environment in which people can find their energy again, be inspired again by the work they do, manage them via boundaries, go check in by the end of a sprint, what has been done, how can we help you even more, leave them be within the sprint. You have a product that they have, you have a Scrum Master there, leave them enact their accountabilities. Make sure that team engagement increases and you will see an increase in the other two aspects, financial returns and customer satisfaction. They're almost a byproduct of increased team engagement. I think it's going to take a while before people start going for this. Yeah, okay, cool. Now, I think we have 15 minutes left, so it's amazing how time flies. Can I do one more last check with you guys? So I've prepared another Mentimeter thing. So let's have a look at that, if you're okay with that. Yeah. Remember this one? Okay. Let's go for the next one. Thinking about the following, what is the biggest impediment to whatever people call agile? But let's see agile as a potential path to unlocking engagement. What is the biggest impediment to agile that you see in your organizations, your environments? Because agile and Scrum can really re-energize people. But why is that not happening then? What do you see happening over there? So voting is open. So again, same idea. You can enter 3 keywords, go to this menti.com, use that code. And let's give ourselves a time box of 2 minutes for that. So what is the biggest, and up to three, what are the biggest impediments that you see that block people from engaging and finding energy, although the company has gone through an agile transformation? Yolo, beautiful things. Fear. That's sort of the opposite of earlier on safety, remember? Rigidity, which is, I like rigidity because that's actually the opposite of agility. Flexibility, responsiveness, rigid structures. Those old structures that we have were very rigid. Yeah. Locking time and scope. Sort of the what I call the keep imposing deadline and delivery pressure on people. Change fatigue.
I don't see the word cloud appearing, at least I don't see it.
Oh, okay. Let's see how we can. It says show results. Do you see it now or no?
Still no.
Oh, okay. I'll see what I can do about that. But you do see the timer, right?
No, it's just literally the top of the like tabs of your Safari probably or browser.
Do you now see it?
Yes.
Oh, I had chosen the wrong window. Sorry for that. Damn. I'll be kind. I'll give you 30 seconds additionally. So from the previous word cloud, at the heart of the word cloud, whatever people do, it was trust. This is fear at the heart of it. I it's cool. Not that I like fear, but I think it's very real. All the V model, is that still in use? I've worked with the V model back in 2001. Oh my God.
Even required in some industries.
Yeah, well, that was work in the pharmaceutical industry, and they assumed they needed something like that to be in line with governance expectations and auditing and so on. Until you talk with auditors and then you find out what they're hoping for, and then you can achieve those things in very different ways too. I like the change fatigue also, honestly. It's one of the problems also with introducing Scrum. I don't know. I know whether you've seen that. You know, a lot of companies I know, they have gone through long time ago, they did stuff like RUP, the Russian Unified Process, and then I changed that to things like PRINCE2, and then they went through a lean phase, and they've gone through a lot of things, a lot of hypes, and people just don't believe it anymore to be serious. Oh yeah, now it is Scrum, and now it's DevOps, and now it's Safe again, and now it's Spotify, whatever. So they hide in the corner somewhere, hoping for the wind to blow over again. And that's a real problem. Sort of be serious about your change. Okay, cool. Thank you. That's a beautiful word cloud. So I see a lot of things. So my thinking is sort of the following. What is the biggest impediment to Agile? And I want to close with this. My feeling overall is looking at a lot of organizations, the biggest impediment to Agile is our ingrained obsession. We seem to be obsessed by wanting to control individuals. That creates a lot of fear. That's sort of the opposite of the first word cloud, trust. It seems to be very difficult to trust people. It seems to be very easy to abuse the term self-organization, to still not trust people. So it seems that we have this culture management, organizational culture. We are ingrained with controlling individuals. We can't let go. We have difficulties shifting from controlling individuals towards creating environment and getting control out of the boundaries, out of what we try to achieve with agility path, out of checking out on the impact we have on the market with our users, on the benefits with engaged teams, and then checking in with teams and facilitating them and helping them to, how can we increase our impact? How can we help you to increase the impact that we're having? So that's sort of a very difficult thing. So I want to thank you a lot. It's amazing how time has been flying. We're near the end of our time box. Shall we use the last like 6-7 minutes for some additional questions?
Yeah, we have questions.
Can you help me out?
Yeah. So the first question is, how to engage with people in outsourcing companies which have been changing projects, products a lot? That is actually quite a frequent, since, for example, here in this region, it's quite a typical outsourcing market, I would say. So the whole of the Eastern Europe, actually.
Oh, yeah. The fact that you're being treated as a little minions for companies far away. I have some very strange experiences with that. Strange in the sense that I've worked with organizations, let's call them somewhere in Western Europe, that have outsourced work that was a while ago to a Polish company or Romanian companies and so on. And when I got to work with them, I had the astonishing finding that the people in Poland or Romania often understood Scrum better than the, let's say, commanding companies in the Netherlands or Belgium or Germany that was, which is very difficult because they think they know it all. And I've met quite some people where they was outsourcing to. Well, in an outsourcing situation, I still stick to my idea that as a team from different companies, you would still need a team zone. You would still need a shared workspace in which you can at least engage more. The counterintuitive aspect of working remotely or in an outsourcing world is that complexity is even higher than in a co-located situation, everybody working for the same company within the company. So you need to do Scrum even more disciplined than in a co-located situation. So have more interaction, more communication. What I found astonishing is that you have that open office situation where people are in the same room and still they are not really connected. It's in a way the same, essentially the same problem. You need a space where people can talk. And if you want to do that in a remote situation, you need communication, technology, equipment, and so on. Nowadays, for me, that means having a real-time open connection all day long between the different locations, so that I have this virtual feeling of in my room, my team room in my company, going up to a screen, saying something, and people via the screen in another location can hear me, and they go up to their screen. That's the closest you can get to sort of, it's still a simulation, the closest you can get to being co-located. If a company, and I've met quite some companies that want to work with a remote provider or outsource their work to a country far away, and unwilling to invest in communication, or unwilling to open up ports and gates on routers and so on to make that happen, that's like, yeah, okay. Set up, please keep setting up for failure then. So even maybe the more difficult position, if you're in the outsourced position like you probably are over there, still try to bring that message to people that, hey, we could do a lot more if we would have this shared workspace, if we would have this communication equipment in place. We could do a lot more. And that was also the idea of Agility Path, by creating measurements, metrics, indicators on value then, that so that you can introduce another way of working, improve, change your way of working, and hopefully taking into account some sort of lagging indicators that you see, we are now able to produce more value, have a bigger impact by having the shared workspace. But it still not takes away that this initial barrier of distrust that you have to get over before you can get that happening. Yep, sorry.
Okay, I'll misuse the opportunity. Now, one question that pops right away into my mind. Would you go with the product owner who is actually at the distributed location or at the client's location? Because in one way, he actually is not a real product owner. He doesn't have that much decision making. You can follow the trail of cash. And in the other, he's disconnected.
Yeah. Well, just if we think about this, there's no fixed rule. So there's no one size whatever answer. But if you think about the accountabilities of Scrum, product owner being the single representative of all users and stakeholders to the team and vice versa, you would rather have a product owner that's more close to the market, to the users, to product management people and so on. And you would rather have a Scrum Master almost more close to the environment in which people have to work. So does that answer your question, Bogdan?
Yes.
That's just, and you will still have the, I have found a lot of value in almost a product owner plus Scrum Master being sort of servant leader duo, helping out teams and helping teams establish connections with users, markets, stakeholders, the organization, and so on. So the additional difficulty is that sort of split up that sort of powerful duo. But thinking this through in terms of the accountability of Scrum, Scrum Masters closer to the teams and product owners closer to the market.
Okay, so we have, I suppose that we can do one more question. So from Justin and his hellos from Romania. So still on the topic of existing ways and self-organizing, also on the results of the last cloud, noticed in the some teams start building gates with their definition of working. Design one sprint ahead, no backend dependency testing done in last sprint. Why do you think they get to this?
The reason that pattern sometimes occurs or applies is the fact that a team is not allowed to do certain stuff. So that often means that, oh yeah, we can only do sort of the coding, some essential first line, whatever testing, but the real integration or the release work is done by another department. And that sometimes happens when organizations establish scrum teams within existing silos, then at most you sometimes have scrum teams that are able to build one component of a system, but they still have to throw over that component over the wall to another team that has to do additional work on that. They all have their own product owner and their own product backlog, but their owner and their backlog is not actually for the product. It's for a part of a product. But that's sometimes an effect that I see by that sort of establishing scrum teams within existing structures and departments, that you create scrum teams according to the old way of organizing the work. And then have one team has to throw over work to the next team. And actually nobody is minding the synergies across the teams and sort of the product level. That's why I miss at most companies the idea of start with product and then organize your scrum for your product rather than set up scrum within existing departments. And then you need courageous people bringing up the idea of product and synergies and so on. Because if you want to combine people from different departments into one team, you will run into conflicts with team leads, resource managers, departments, etc. and so on.
Okay. Thanks a lot. It's been a pleasure having you, Gunter. Thanks for answering all the questions. And I see quite a few positive comments. It's been a really fun time and really informative for me, and I hope for the rest of the group. We'll share the recording once it's been processed, for just to see if anything's wrong, audio and so on.
I will also share a PDF with a slide so that you can share that within the group too.
Thanks a lot. Great. We'll do so.
Okay. So thank you, Bogdan, Boris, for the invitation. Thank you, Jane, for the informative questions and the other people with questions. So and thank you all for spending 2 hours of a beautiful night with me.
And see you next Wednesday. We'll have James actually talking on precisely disarming estimates and how to help teams there. And see you on next Wednesday. Have a great day, all.
Thank you.
Okay, cool. Thank you all. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Gunther.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.